Hello and welcome to the Lharbur Show. My name is Luke Harbur. I am your host. And today we have the incredible Darrington. Darrington is an actor and he's also just a fantastic man. Darrington, how are you doing today?
I am fantastic. Thank you so much for having me. This is amazing.
Yes, you're super welcome. Are you ready for the first segment of our show?
Yes.
Harbur Hot Takes.
Yes, let's do it.
Okay. So with Harbur Hot Takes, Mr. Darrington here has three topics that he's selected and he only gets one sentence to share his thoughts on those three topics. So Darrington, are you ready?
Yes. Yes, okay. Let's do it.
Amazing. Okay, so the first topic. What are your thoughts on pets? One sentence.
The most incredible gift you will ever receive.
Oh, that's so sweet. Very good. Okay, topic number two. What are your thoughts on unions?
A frightening but important next step.
Great. Very good. Okay. And topic number three. What are your thoughts on college? One sentence.
There will never be a more enlightening experience.
Wow. What a guy. That's awesome. And now for our second segment of the show, which is Harbur Talk. Darrington and I have three topics we are going to talk about within a 9-minute period. One topic came from a guest, one topic came from me, and one topic came from the beautiful Darrington here. And by guest, I mean a person who submitted it to the channel. Yes. So, Mr. Darrington, are you ready to explore these three topics within a 9-minute period?
Absolutely.
Wonderful. We are starting the 9-minute timer in 3, 2, 1.
Sweet. We're on the clock.
We're on the clock. So something that I would love to talk to you about, this is something that I have not really been able to explore with someone on the show yet, is gun control.
Yeah.
Now, why do you think someone would think that's a taboo topic?
I think that there are a couple of hot button issues that have been cycling, especially within the media for the last couple of years, that because of its representation, we have gotten from what the issue actually is. Like when we see these certain taboo topics or these topics that have been under fierce debate in Congress or other places in our government, instead of talking about what the actual issue is, we instead become entrenched in what it means for the Democrats or the Republicans or the liberals or the conservatives. And we start, in my opinion, debating semantics instead of what the actual issue on the table is. So to answer your question, I think gun control has become such a taboo topic because we're not really talking about it anymore, but somehow if that is where we start the conversation, we end up on the rights of American citizens, and then we end up on the privileges of people who have money versus the privileges of people who need background check, all of these other things, instead of what gun control is and what people are trying to achieve with it. We never end up there. We're always somewhere else.
Right. That's a very beautiful way of saying it. It's almost as if when we have any kind of taboo topic like that, there's polarization. Mm-hmm. So people shut off. Mm-hmm. They don't want to see, I call it like the battleground of the situation. Yes. So, I mean, gun control for someone can literally just be at a shooting range. It's a leisurely activity. For some people, it's hunting. Mm-hmm. Gun control rings a bell for some people that, oh my God, literally the United States is one of the largest arms producers mm-hmm. in the entire world. Mm-hmm. There's that angle. Someone that I really love as an advocate of talking about difficult things is Killer Mike. Have you ever heard of that guy before?
Yes.
Killer Mike is amazing. He talks about how there are so many people within lower socioeconomic environments mm-hmm. that would never get rid of their guns mm-hmm. because of police brutality.
Right.
It's like that is their defense. Mm-hmm. You get rid of our guns, we don't have a defense anymore. Mm-hmm. So there's so many different ways of looking at it.
It's very personal.
It's personal mm-hmm. and it goes deeper when it comes to policy and when it comes to environment. Mm-hmm. What do you think of that?
It's as true as all of that is, even that, because that is exactly the slippery slope that begins when we start talking about gun control as an umbrella issue. Because what is the actual thing, right? The entire purpose, the reason that we're talking about it in the first place, is because we as Americans have identified that there is a substantial increase in violence, gun-related, that is happening here and not happening anywhere else. Right. And wanting to limit that violence is not a bipartisan issue. I think we all agree. Anybody you'd ask would say, I don't want more people shot.
Right. I would like less. At the end of the day.
Right. So that, like, we're not really arguing over the premise of gun control. That's what's so interesting to me. I would challenge you to find somebody who loves that we have the highest amount of homicide, you know, in the world.
Yeah.
And that's not you, for everybody fact checking, like, I don't know.
It's very high.
But I know that it's up there, and I know it's continuing to rise, and I know that we as a nation fully are not doing anything about it, which is why people who are very pro gun control are so angry. I can think of a lot of being black, being gay, it's hard not to be a liberal. And so seeing this side of so many different issues, I can understand the anger and I can understand the frustration, because we seem to be at a stopping point of all of these issues. It seems like instead of actually talking about what the problem is and trying to fix it, we get so stuck on the personal that nothing happens. And when we're not seeing that change, that's when people get angry and more arguments begin. So it's hard. It is hard to have a civil conversation about these issues.
That's very beautifully said. Then that brings me to a second topic that I'd like to talk to you today about. Talk about the scariest moment of your life.
This is incredible because it has to do with guns. I am from Kansas City, Missouri. I live right on the border of my childhood home. It's right on the border of Kansas City, Missouri, and Raytown. And I live on a dead-end street, which when I was growing up, gangs would use as the starting place for drag races. And I very much remember looking out of my window and seeing the entire bit, right? Like these two beautiful cars and crowds of people surrounding them, literally a woman with flags in the middle of the street, and hearing these roaring engines, and they would go. And it always surprised me that this was never something that was shut down, but it wasn't until one day something had happened. I don't know what the circumstances of the race was or what was happening, but there were so many people right in front of my house and everyone around the neighborhood, and something race-related broke into an argument, which escalated to a fight, which escalated to firearms. And I remember my mom, once we started hearing gunshots go off right at our front door, I remember my mom swooping me up. I had to have been like 8 or 9. And going into the most central room in the house as protection, while my dad went and got one of his guns, because we have 2 gun safes in our home. I had been trained for shooting since I was 8 or 9. And he went out and he grabbed a gun. We did not call the police. And he went outside. And I was like, that's it. Like, I'm never going to see him again. The absolute worst case scenario is that he gets gunned down, they come in here and get us. I had no idea what was going to happen. And once he had got outside, there were more gunshots that went off. And my mom and I were just terrified. I remember sobbing in the computer room, which was the middle of our house. And just a little bit later, he came back in and said that everyone had cleared out and there was no sign of anyone else. And that was the last time that there was any races on our street. But I had made up my mind. I was like, that is it. That is the end of my dad. Like, there's a gunfight happening outside, and he just took a gun and went into it. Like, that's it.
So to this day, how do you feel about looking back on that memory? What does it feel like?
It is an incredible reminder of bravery on my dad's part, because he was so ready to get to the bottom of whatever it was and protect us that it seemed so selfless. Like, he didn't really care what happened to him in that moment, as long as whatever was out there was not a threat to what was in his house, which is incredible. And I think so fatherly and so brave. It is one of the strongest memories I have of my mother, of which I do not have many. I lost her when I was 12, so just a couple years after that. So it's one of the closest moments that I ever felt to her, when we were so, like, ready to have lost something. And it reminds me very much of where I'm from, because I live in Overland Park now, and everybody leaves their front doors unlocked, and there doesn't really seem to be issues like that that happen that much. There's still crime. There's crime everywhere. I don't want to, like, paint that stereotype, but... And I didn't come from a ghetto, either. I don't want it to feel that way, but... It's a very different upbringing I had than the life that I live in now, and I am grateful to have a reminder of that.
Wow. Really beautifully said. Thank you for sharing.
Of course.
Really means a lot. And then the last topic we want to talk about today is what you want to talk about. And
yes, I am, as an actor, very, very passionate about color-conscious casting and color-conscious representation. And that is another, in my opinion, very taboo topic, or something that we have difficulty speaking about because these issues of fairness come up, and these issues of, it's very much an equivalent of affirmative action. I think that's the easiest way to explain it to somebody who is not within the theater or within the general performing world. But the number one reason I am an actor is because the way that we see ourselves in media reflects the way we are and the way that we want to be. And I know that because when I grew up, I was attracted to so many of, I had the opportunity to see myself on TV so much. And so few people can say that. I had shows like The Proud Family, and That's a Raven. I watched a lot of Disney. But even on PBS and Cartoon Network, there weren't a lot of them, but there were Black kids. But I never saw them on stage. And theater wasn't something that was hugely important to me until, oh no.
No, keep on going.
Ah, okay, I'm going to make it quick.
You're good.
Theater wasn't super important to me until I was in my adolescence, and it wasn't until then that I had realized that I didn't feel like I had a capability of doing it because I had never seen it. I saw my first Black actor on stage when I was in seventh grade, and I pretty much made up my mind then and there that it was something I was interested in, but I didn't really get into acting in college, and now I see the value in seeing yourself. And we tried to fix that problem with a term called colorblind casting, where it didn't matter. We were going to pretend like we didn't see race. You could just go anywhere, and it didn't matter what color you were, which was a noble effort. But to erase the idea of nationality, ethnicity, and race in a part is to erase the culture and the heritage that comes along with that. And because of the way our society is set up, when you see a Black person in a certain role, you're just going to have ideas. You're just going to have certain thoughts that come to your head. I'll never forget, I did a production of You Can't Take It With You in college, and I was supposed to be like the rich, ingenue male lead. And I had two white parents who were in the show. And a lady from the community wrote into the community newspaper after seeing the production, admitting that when I came on stage and said who I was supposed to be, she laughed. It was absolutely wow. Inconceivable to her that I would be in that part because of what I looked like. And that is what colorblind casting does. It makes people try to figure out some sort of way to rationalize or believe something that they are inherently equipped not to. So color conscious casting, in my opinion, is the way to go, which is where we've landed. And it is a much better way to both realize what we're looking at, to not try and fool the audience into thinking that we're something that we're not, but also that people of specific races are in roles for a reason, to make you challenge, to make you think. There's a big difference, and I think it is often abused, and it's still very much a fight that I am passionate about, seeing people of color, seeing visibility and representation, not for the sake of it, but because those are stories that we need to hear and share so those people can see themselves at home.
You there. Are. And I'm
sorry, that was like 10 minutes.
No. You are a wonderfully articulate man, and I am so blessed you have been on this show. Thank you so much.
Thank you for
Darrington.
Having me.
That's amazing. Thank you so much for being a part of the show today. Darrington, are you ready for the end slate?
Let's do it.
Okay, here we go.
Pause, play, be kind, and make a difference.
We'll see you guys soon. This is like, I love this song.
It's so good. It's
so good.
A song.
With it. I never hear a whiff.